So without further ado, I'm just going to bring up a guy right now who, again, we have some great golf stories, go through some of your questions, some more if you write them down, but a guy who has helped me and many, many others along their paths, not just learning how to do golf shots and things of that nature, but also as far as their faith is concerned. So stand by for a little hour or so, or 45 minutes maybe, of some golf stories, a little discussion about maybe some things more important for a man who you're going to feel like is your friend once you leave here. You're going to say, you know what? Bernhard Langer is a little different than we see presented by Golf Channel on the air between the ropes. He's got another side to him. He's equally as prepared, methodical, and all that, but as open, caring, and also a lot of fun. Ladies and gentlemen, two-time Masters winner, 101 wins around the world, including 29 on the PGA Tour Champions, Bernie.
Thank you. Thank you, Dave. Thank you. This song? First of all, welcome and thank you for spending this evening with us. I know you could do so many other things, and especially for you baseball fans, you probably are checking the clock, you know, when are we getting out of here? And I will promise you, you'll get out of here in plenty of time to watch a lot of baseball tonight. So who's for Chicago and who's for Cleveland? All right, yeah, well, all across the board, so. Somebody's going to be happy, right? No.
Big baseball fan right here.
Yeah, right. Sooner or later. My daughter is dating one, so I'll better get to learn. But where do I start? I think I'll just start with a few stories. Those are all true stories that happened in my life. So maybe we'll start with the Masters. You all know when you win the Masters, you get taken into Butler Cabin. So 1985, I was fortunate enough to win the Masters. They take me into Butler Cabin. Jim Nance, I think, was there, and the chairman, and then the past champion who puts the green jacket on, and there's always a couple of questions before they do that. And Jim Nance says, well, Bernhard, how, you know, were you watching the leaderboard at all today? And I'm going, you know, Jim, I've learned the last couple of years that it's no good watching leaderboards, because if you're in the lead, you basically play defensive and protect your lead, and that's not what got you there. What got you there was aggressiveness and playing well. And if I'm looking at the leaderboard and I'm 8 shots behind, I get depressed because I'm so far behind, nobody cares, you know, and it doesn't really matter. So I kind of said, I try not to watch leaderboards anymore. And he goes, well, how about today? I said, you know, I tried hard not to. But I said literally, and this was on national television, obviously, over 100 million people watching worldwide, televised to over 40 countries. And I said, and on the after the ninth hole, I was in the second last group playing with Seve, and Curtis Strange and Raymond Floyd were in the last group. I said, I looked at that leaderboard, and I said, and Jesus Christ, I couldn't believe I'm 4 shots behind Curtis Strange. And so quickly, the next question came, you know, let's move away from that subject. And as you imagine, I wasn't a believer at the time. And, you know, Jesus Christ, I heard it a lot of times from my fellow golfers. And it's, to me, it was a powerful expression. Everybody else used it kind of thing. So didn't think much about it. Well, a few weeks later, I get home and I had hundreds and hundreds of letters. I'm thinking, well, they're all congratulatory notes because I just won my first Majors, the Masters. I won the Hilton Head the following week as well. And, you know, 2 in a row. And so I opened some, and about 90% of them were, who are you to mention Jesus Christ on national television in vain? I'm going, wow, what did I do? You know, so anyways, fast forward, now we go 8 years later, 93, and I won the Masters again. Into Butler Cabin, Jim Nance. First question, he goes, well, Bernhard, you know, how does it feel to win the Masters twice? Which one was more meaningful or more important? And I said something like, well, Jim, you know, it's fantastic to win the greatest tournament in the world twice, but this one means a lot more because I won it on Easter Sunday when we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so he immediately, you know, moved away to another question. And media is not allowed to talk about God, you know. But so I might be the only guy who's mentioned Jesus Christ on national television through the Masters telecast in the Butler Cabin twice, once in a good way and once in a bad way.
probably the answer from then on in was hoping you weren't going to win again. Because he'd come in and say it again, he's got to change the question. But now winning the Masters, you're also able then to go to the Masters Club Dinner, the Champions Dinner, where you get to ask questions sometimes. Were there ever any times you brought up questions or suggestions to the folks at the Masters?
Oh, yeah, there's, you know, the past Champions Dinner, they call it, which is maybe the most fun dinner I'll ever attend every year. It's only the champions and the chairman of the club. So very exclusive, you know, one big table. Everybody sits around the big tables, usually around 40 of us. And I remember years ago, this was probably in the 80s, the chairman would get up and say, well, gentlemen, I'm sure you find the course to your liking. You know, everything looks really good. We've had good growth. They have heating under the ground. They have these sub-air systems sucking rain out of there if they need to. They got everything. Anyways, they said, you know, is there anything, you know, that we could improve or do better? And I think Jack Nicklaus got up, or Arnie, I can't remember who, and said, yeah, Mr. Chairman, you know, we noticed that half the fairway is mowed away from the tee box and the other half is mowed into us. And if you just hit it on this side, the ball, when it hits the ground, it takes off and runs 40, 50 yards. But if you hit it just a couple of feet on the other side and the grass is growing into you, the ball stops much quicker. It might run 10 or 20 yards. So the chairman said, all right, I'll make a note of that. And sure enough, next day, everything was mowed into us. So. So Augusta's playing a lot longer now. But thinking of a story a few years back when Seve Ballesteros was still alive, and we were great rivals. I mean, we really were. There was the big five in Europe: Faldo, Lyle, Woosnam, myself, and Seve. And Seve and I were about as opposite as can be. Seve was this tall, dark-haired Spanish, you know, whatever you call it, had all the outgoing personality and flair and everything you would want to have in anybody, you know. And I'm the stoic German, short, blonde, just, you know, more of an introvert than anything else, and just we're as opposite can be, but we're dominating the tour, so we're playing against each other a lot. But this was just before that happened. In 1980, I'm on the putting green at Sunningdale, and I've been on tour now for 3.5 years. Haven't done a whole lot. Won one big tournament, the under 25, but nothing else. And Seve comes over and takes my putter and says, so what are you putting with? I'm going, well, this bullseye. And he grabs it, hits two or three putts, and gives it back to me, shakes his head, and walks off. And I'm going, hey, Seve, whoa, hold on. Why are you walking away? Why are you shaking your head? What's wrong with my putter? He goes, you want to know? I say, yeah, I want to know. You're the greatest putter I've ever seen, and I'm not very good at this point. He goes, well, it's too light, and it doesn't have enough loft. So I'm thinking, well, he's one of the greatest players, just won two or three majors already at age 19. I'll better do what he says. So I go into the pro shop, look around, can't find anything I like. So I ask the assistant pro, is there any other putters you have anywhere? He goes, well, you know, maybe there's a little room back there and there's a bag of really old clubs and putters. You know, just look around, whatever you see, you're happy to, you know, we're happy if you take it out the putting green and try it. So I found this old bullseye with a flange on it, took it out, hit a few putts, and liked it. It was a little heavier, it had a little more loft, the ball was rolling good. So I came back and said, I really enjoy this putter. Can I buy it? And is it possible for me to have it? Say, oh yeah, this was an old lady. She stopped playing. She gave us her clubs and they're for sale and you can have it for £5. Best £5 I ever invested. I finished third that week. I finished second the following week and I won my first European championship the third week. So three tournaments in a row. And a big deal because Seve gave me the pointer. If he hadn't talked to me and given me that tip, I would still be using my other putter, I guess, and probably finishing 30th most of the time.
But you didn't always follow the tips that Seve gave you. He was your Ryder Cup captain?
Not always. Oh, well, yeah, there was one story. We're in Valderrama, 97 maybe, and he was the captain and I was one of the players. And last hole is a big dog leg, almost at straight angles. And Monty was my partner, and he hit it through the dog leg next to a big oak tree, just like, you know, the oak tree was 10 feet away, and I was in semi-rough. And I had to go under the oak tree, had branches, had to go under the oak tree over there. Then across the fairway, about 25 yards across, there were taller oak trees on the left side. So I would have to slice it under this branch, over those, and slice it 45 yards to get it back on the green. So I'm looking at this and I'm thinking, this is not great. And I see Seve coming up with this cart, with his captain cart, and coming to a squeaking halt, jumping out, and he goes and says, Bernhard, have you looked at this? Have you considered? You take your one iron, you open it up, you go under this branch, you go over there, you cut it 45 yards, you're on the green, and Monty has a birdie putt, and you win the match. And I'm going, Seve, it's okay. Well, we got it. It's okay. You know, I got here because I'm a decent player. I didn't get here because whatever, your advice. So I called Monty over and said, Monty, what do you think? You know, I can try this one iron, but the odds I'm pulling this off out of the rough to slice it 45 yards are just close to zero. So he says, you're right. You know, just chip it out there. Give me about 100 yards in. That's my wedge. I'll knock it close. You hold the putt. We still win. So I chip it out. He knocks it up there, 8 feet or 10. I make the putt, and we still won the match. But, you know, Seve would have taken his one iron and tried this impossible shot and probably would have pulled it off as well.
And Seve was a little bit intimidating as far as, obviously, playing Ryder Cup matches, et cetera. Sometimes we get rules officials a little bit nervous when it came down to rulings.
That was my next story. You must be thinking alike. So Seve, you know, as it was an intimidating figure, and whenever he needed a ruling, he would often argue. I was paired with him a lot, so he would argue with the rules officials if he didn't get it his way. So on this particular day, he's playing with Tony Johnson, who is from Zimbabwe, a pretty good golfer, and they were paired together at this links course in Scotland, and Seve outdrove Tony every hole, 25, 30, 35 yards, every time. So they play the 14th hole blind tee shot over the sand dune, and they couldn't see where the balls ended up from the tee, but Tony walked ahead, and one ball was 25 yards short than the other one, so immediately goes to that ball, and I'm going to stand up doing this. So the ball was right here, and he's playing this direction, but it was in a big divot and right up against the front lip. So he's taking his stance, and he's realizing there's a sprinkler head right there, and there's a sprinkler head right there, but, you know, he can't really stand like that. So, but he had this idea. So he says, Seve, come over here, have a look at this. So what's the matter, Tony? What's going on? He said, well, have a look. This is my ball. So if I play a slice, I'm aiming 30 yards this way, and I'm open, you know, just I'm standing on the sprinkler, and I get relief, right? Seve goes, No, Tony, come on, you can't hit a slice out of that lie. You need to just, you know, play a normal shot. So Tony says, well, what if I play a draw? And he comes over here and stands on this sprinkler head, aims a little to the right. I can hit a 30-yard draw. Seve says, Tony, the lie is so bad, you can't hit any shot out of there. You can maybe move it 50 yards, so you just need to play it where it is. So Tony looks at Seve and says, oh, that's quite all right. It's your ball.
Tony Johnson is a South African, like you said, and he's a terrific guy. But it seems like all the South Africans kind of have a lot of different personalities. And one of the guys was named Simon Hobday, who I guess you guys spent some time on the European tour early on.
I spent 1 week with him. I wish I hadn't, but. I was looking for a guy to share my room, okay, because I didn't have any money. I was 18, joined the European Tour, come from a poor background, and I couldn't afford a hotel room by myself, so I always looked for somebody to share the room with. And Simon Hobday comes up one day and says, I heard you're looking for a roommate for the Dutch Open. I said, yes, I am. He says, well, I'm Simon, and hadn't met him before, and I'd be happy to share the room with you that week. I said, fantastic, here's the address, the name, when you come, and he said Monday night. Said, okay, I'm already going to be there. So he arrives Monday and didn't even say hi, Bernhard, or whatever, opens the door and says, hey, you know, do we have a bathtub or a shower? And I'm laying on bed and I'm thinking, well, I'm not sure. Have a look. So he goes in and goes, yeah, we have both. He goes, fantastic. So I hear him run the water, you know, put the plug in, runs the tub. And then he comes back out the room and grabs his whole suitcase and drags it into the bathroom. Go, man, he must be very modest. He just doesn't want me to see him in his underwear or whatever. So, but I'm interested now. So the bathroom door was still open. So I'm kind of peeking around the corner. And he takes his whole suitcase, everything he owned, from cashmere to black to white to yellow to green, everything, throws it all into the water, you know, into the bathtub. He comes over and grabs a bar of soap, takes the paper off and throws the bar of soap in there. Then he comes back out and his golf bag is still covered up in the travel bag. So he unzips it, unzips the next one, pulls his one iron out, goes back in and does this in the bathtub. And then he comes out with the biggest grin and says, that's my laundry done for the week.
So that's
what I got into. So maybe a couple more Simon Hope Day stories and we move on. So he comes over here. He's playing the Champions Tour several years ago, and he's a great ball striker. I mean, I would stop to watch him on the range for 15, 20 minutes. He was that good. I don't do that with a lot of people. But he's having the yips. He's having putting problems. And he's now on the Champions Tour. And one day he shows up with this Mexican sombrero. You all know that big, big, big hat, you know. So everybody's that sees him on the range and on the plane goes, come on, Simon, what are you doing now? You know, what's this thing for? And he hits a few balls, and on the follow-through, he whacks himself on the head, and he has to adjust it, and, you know. Anyways, he goes out and goes, birdie, 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 par, birdie, birdie, par, birdie, par, birdie, birdie, par, birdie, birdie, par. He's like 11 under after 14, 15 holes. So he comes to the next hole, hits an 8-iron to about 8 feet. He's got another birdie putt and gets a little aggressive, rams it about 3.5 feet past, and he misses his 3.5-footer, and he's 3 putts from 8 feet, and he would have gone 12 under at that point. So he's so mad, and he grabs his sombrero and slams it on the green and goes, I didn't think you'd recognize me under my hat. So one last one. He's playing in Scottsdale, some tournament, and if any of you have been to Scottsdale, there's Pima Road, this road up the mountain. And he sleeps through the alarm. So he wakes up by himself at some point, looks at the clock and says, oh my God, I got 23 minutes to my tee time, and it's like a 18-minute car drive or whatever. So he just puts clothes on, didn't shave, didn't brush his hair, nothing, just in the car. And off he goes, and there's like 45 mile an hour speed limit. He goes 75, 80, whatever he can do just to make his tee time. He's 100 yards from the exit, and there's a policeman with a radar gun and clocks him and pulls him over. And he goes, oh, now I'm dead now. No way I'm going to make my tee time. So he pulls the car over on the side of the road. The policeman, almost with a bit of a grin on his face, goes, I've been waiting for you all day, son. And Simon had the window down and goes, well, officer, I got here as fast as I could.
True story. I was actually running the tournament when that happened out in Scottsdale. And we used to have a champions clinic where we'd have Arnold hit the driver, Jack would hit a 3-wood, and sort of go on club by club from there. Simon had won the U.S. Senior Open, so he was part of this clinic. Gary Player was as well, and they're countrymen from South Africa. And Gary went right before Simon, and he got up and he talked about this ranch that he had back in South Africa. And he said, I can get on my horse and I can ride all day, and I don't get to the border of my property, to the east. He said, I can ride to the west all day on my horse, and I don't get to the border of my property. Same with the south and the north. And then he gets up and he gives a tip. Simon gets up and he said, that was inspiring, Gary, about your ranch, because I had a horse like that once too. Washing machine with Simon Hobson. Way before that, there was a young boy in Anheuser, Germany, who was trying to figure out what he was going to do with his life and trying to figure out who he was going to be. Tell us about your earliest days discovering the game of golf and why.
Yeah, I grew up in this little town called Anhausen, about 800 people in Bavaria, near Munich, and had a brother and a sister. They were both older. And we come from a poor background. My father was a bricklayer, my mother a housewife. So when I was about eight and a half, my older brother started caddying. There was one golf course in the whole city, which was about 5 miles away. And he rode his bicycle there and back and started earning a few Deutschmarks. Every time he got a bag, he came home with a few Deutschmarks. And I was impressed, you know. So I said, hey, you need to take me along. I want to earn some money too. And at first he goes, no, you're too short, you're too little, you're not strong enough. But we didn't have to carry the bags, we had pull trolleys. So I nagged him, and eventually he said, all right, come along. So I rode my bicycle up there, and my first bag I ever caddied for was the club champion, handicap 2, best player in the club. And I had very good eyes at the time, and I found a way to never lose a golf ball, even though in big, tall rough like that. I would pick a target way out there, and I would walk straight at where the ball went, like a tree or something. Walk straight at it. If I missed it, I would return this way and that way, and I always find a golf ball. Hardly ever lost a golf ball as a caddy. So anyways, this guy liked me so much, he said, from now on, I'm going to ask for you all the time. You're going to be my regular caddy, none of the other guys. So that was a thrill, and I was earning money. So my first love with golf wasn't really the love of golf. It was the love of money, earning money as a caddy. But it didn't take long for me to really get hooked on the game of golf. And there were about 12 caddies at the time at this local club. It was a private club, not a large membership. And most of them were working during the week. So they mostly came sort of late afternoon, sometimes mostly on the weekend. So we had time to practice as caddies, and they would let us. They would let us practice on the range. Once we got to a decent level, they would let us play. So I constantly played, but thing is, we didn't have any clubs at first. So a member gave us 4 clubs that he discarded. He bought a new set. He said, oh, these 4 you guys can have, you know, sort of. And it was a 2-wood. They all had bamboo shafts, so now I'm dating myself, right? A 2-wood, a 3-iron, a 7-iron, no wedges, and a putter with a bent shaft. So now you know why my putting problems, where they came from all these years. So we, you know, that's how I got into golf, and then enjoyed it very much, caddying and playing golf. I was never an amateur. I finished school at age 15. I did the basic 9 years, and so it was time for me to go to work. Well, if I had done any other job, I wouldn't have earned enough money to become a member and play golf. All the clubs were private memberships, and they were too expensive. So I figured, well, if I become a golf professional, I can teach golf, help people to be better players, and that way I can play myself too. So I decided to become a golf professional. So I go to the Institute of Job Placement. That's something we do in Germany, and I had my 2 parents with me. I was 14 and a half, almost 15. And the man on the other side of the desk goes, well, young man, what do you want to do with your life? I said, well, sir, I want to become a golf professional. He goes, a what? I said, a golf professional. He goes, what is that? I'm going, well, it's somebody that teaches other people how to play golf, like a tennis coach or whatever. He goes, well, excuse me for a minute. He left the room, came back 2 minutes later, sat down and said, I have to disappoint you, but it's not a recognized profession in Germany, and I highly recommend that you learn something decent. And my 2 parents are sitting next to me, and they both go, this man is right. Maybe you should learn something decent, you know. And my jaw dropped, and I was very disappointed. But I knew this is really what I wanted to do. And I had a job offer in Munich as well, Munich Country Club. So my parents came with me. They interviewed kind of the head professional who was going to be in charge with me. And they said, you sure he can go to church on Sundays? And you make sure you help him to grow up, how to dress and how to take care of himself and teach him manners and all that kind of stuff. And he said, yes, I will. And so off I went, and I was assistant pro for about 3.5 years. During that time, Jack Nicklaus came to our club to do an exhibition match. And I was about 16 at that point. Nobody really had ever heard of me or met me except the members at the club. So Jack was playing in front of our members on our course, and they invited two of the best German amateurs, and they asked me. No idea why. Why would they ask me? I was a reasonable player, but what an honor. So I was so nervous. I hadn't played any tournaments. I was never an amateur, never had a handicap, never played any tournaments except for maybe five caddy tournaments once a year. And now I'm playing with or against Jack Nicklaus on my home course in front of my own people. And I was shaking, literally shaking physically. And I just remember two or three shots. I shanked an 8-iron, I think, on the third hole. That was really embarrassing. You know, way over there, I'm aiming this way, and the ball goes that way. And then the fifth hole was a par 5, and I hit 3-iron for my second shot, and I pull-hooked it, hit a lady on the shoulder, one of the spectators, and the ball bounced onto the green. So I felt really bad. I go down there, so, "Are you all right?" And she said, yeah, I'm fine. And I was able to make the putts. So I at least made one eagle during the round, but was really embarrassed, you know, with all the stuff that was going on. And at the end, we finished the round, and the media asked Jack, "Well, what do you think of your three playing competitors?" And he said, "Well, the two amateurs have great technique, and they show a lot of, you know, prospect. They could be really good players." So he talked about them, and then they said, "Well, what about the young pro?" Says, "Well, he's got a big heart, but he's got a long ways to go." Yeah, so I had a grip like this and shot club face and all that kind of stuff. So anyways, I moved on with my career. I was fortunate enough to win the German Close Championship at age 17. I beat two other guys in the playoff and was the youngest winner to ever win the National German Close Championship at 17. And there was a businessman from Cologne who said, "Well, young man, if you ever want to make it on tour, let me know, because I'll support you financially." I said, "Whoa, that's a thrill. I got one more year to do with my apprenticeship, and I would probably love to come back to you in a year's time." And so I did. He backed me somewhat. He didn't give me enough to be, you know, totally free, but I had some money to go and play. I still had to earn money to draw out even, and I paid him back 50% of my winnings. So in the end, he never really lost a lot of money, but it was a great, you know, whatever, cushion for me to know I had a little bit of money to go out on tour. And I drove, my very first tournament was the Portuguese Open, which is on the far southwest corner of Europe, and I grew up near Munich. So I drove there because I couldn't afford flying, and I couldn't afford a caddy, so I had pulled my own trolley. I couldn't afford a lot of things, couldn't afford a hotel half the time, so I stayed in my car and things like that. But I went there and the greens were running about 13 on the stimp meter. Well, I grew up in Germany where the greens are running 8, maybe 7. And I just got scared and I wanted to succeed quickly. I felt a lot of pressure. Started to get the yips, first time in my life, 18 years old, and I'm getting the yips and I'm just putting horrible. You know, I'm making 38 shots and 42 putts and stuff like that. Just really depressing. But I was fortunate enough to finish fifth in my third tournament. I was playing the Madrid Open 2 weeks later and finished fifth and made some money. And I also realized at that point, well, I'm a pretty good ball striker compared to the other guys I play with, but my short game's not there yet because I had no one to compare myself with. There was never a German player on any tour at that point. I was really the first, and I didn't know what to expect or what was coming my way. So it was all a big learning experience and learning curve. So I, you know, moved forward and was able to make a bunch of cuts and stay exempt, and the rest is kind of history. There was one unique thing that happened when I was 23. I played the World Under 25 Championships in southern France. So anyone under 25 years of age could come and play this tournament, and there was John Cook was there, and Jim Nelford, and a whole bunch of Europeans and all over the world. And I won by 17 strokes, which may still be a record, I don't know. But that it was, I had to laugh. I made so many putts, it was just a joke. You know, from being a yipper to making that many putts, it's like, it's so cool, you know, the game. The game is so much more fun when that ball goes in the hole. So yeah, that was really how I got into golf. Then I came over here in the 80s, met my wife in 83. I was playing the Inverary Classic, which is now the Honda Classic down in Fort Lauderdale, and ran into this girl as I came out of the locker room. She was standing with her sister there, and introduced myself, and we went out for dinner, and you know, that's 9 months later we were married. It was pretty quick. So then we were blessed with four wonderful children. We have daughter Jackie, she's 30, she's married now, lives in Fort Lauderdale. Then we have a 26-year-old son, Stefan. He lives in New York in the financial world. He works there and just got married in July to a girl from Colorado. And then we have a 23-year-old daughter, Christina. She just graduated from FAU and is out in LA. So our kids are everywhere, as you can imagine right now. And she's dating the baseball player, so I'm gonna really learn more about baseball, as I told you. And then we have a 16-year-old who is at home, Jason. So we have two sons and two daughters. Been very blessed, been married for 32 years, and just enjoy living in this country. Think it's the greatest country of all, and it's very sad that you seem to vote for presidents that that disunite the country instead of united. But maybe I shouldn't go there at all. But that's my neutral position. Okay, I don't get to vote. I have a German passport. So
I want to echo what you said about the family. Not just Vicky Langer is a terrific lady, but every family seems to have kind of, you know, the black sheep. The Langer family is a group, four kids, who when you see the way they interact with one another, I've got great pictures of like the brothers just hanging with each other and the sisters loving each other and talking with one another, and the way they deal with their parents, it's a remarkable, remarkable group of people. But they obviously all came up. I want to clarify one quick thing, because he said that in his first Master victory, he wasn't a believer, yet he had been an altar boy and went to church basically his entire
life.
I mean, your mom obviously was an impact on you as far as that was concerned. So when I started going to the fellowships, I looked around and I noticed that basically everyone who had won the Charles Schwab Cup, the Players of the Year, they were all in the same room. That's not why I went. It took me a while, you know, once the questions were answered. When was the moment, really, between those two Masters wins, when your faith clicked in, when you became not just someone who went to church, but someone who now truly believed in God?
All right, well, let me give you a little bit of background. So I grew up in Bavaria, and I went to church every single day, not just Sundays. We had school in our town, and before school, I went to church. It was only a half-hour service, but I was in church nevertheless. I was altar boy for 7 years. I went to confession. I said the rosemary millions of times, it seems like, and on it goes. So what I was taught in my church was basically that I had to be a good person to earn my way to heaven. I had to be better than the average. I had to be, you know, don't lie, don't cheat, don't steal, don't murder, all that kind of stuff, which is all great. But I've lied. I might have even stolen stuff when I was little, and I've done things wrong, and I knew I did. And there was never a guarantee, according to those teachings at the time, that I, first of all, that I could have a personal relationship with God and myself. Secondly, that I would have a guarantee to go to heaven, because I never quite measured up, and heaven is a perfect place, and I'm a sinner, and I knew I was a sinner. And so with this in mind, I still prayed, you know, quite a bit, and I still went to church, even on tour. I went to church on Sundays, but I had no personal relationship with God. So I come over here, as I told you, 85. I'm, 27 years old at that time. And I win my first major. Actually, that year I won 7 tournaments in 5 different continents, which is mind-boggling to me. But I was number one in the world rankings. I was top of the money list. I had houses, cars. I had a beautiful young wife. We just married a year earlier. I had everything going for me. I was healthy, I was strong, I was famous. I had money. I had everything, you know, many of us are chasing after. Yet when I woke up or during that night of the Masters, my first Masters win, I felt this emptiness inside of me that I couldn't pinpoint. I'm going, why do you feel that way? You just won your major. You've tried for 10, 15 years to win a major. Now you've done it. You should be happy and excited. And I was excited, but there was still something. I couldn't pinpoint it what it was, but it was emptiness. So it was great to wake up on Monday morning and see my name all over the papers and, you know, all positive stories and this and that, but that emptiness was still there. So I drove to Hilton Head to play the next tournament, played a practice round with Bobby Clampett. And Bobby, at the end of the day on Tuesday, said, why don't you join us for Bible study on Wednesday night? And I'm going, Bible study? What's that? What are you guys doing? We said, well, we have a chaplain, Larry Moody is his name, and he just picks out a certain topic or a certain part of the Bible and explains it to us. So I told Bobby, well, I might come, not sure yet. So I figured, well, I'm, you know, I believe in God. I've been going to church. I know most of the Bible stories. Heard preachers for over 20 years. So I tell my wife, and she has a similar background to me. And we decided to go. So we walk into this room, and there were all sorts of people, you know, some of the players, wives, caddies, coaches, whatever. Everybody was welcome. And I don't know if Larry Moody, the chaplain, changed his message that night or whether that was his message anyways, but he spoke about the book of John. And in the book of John, there was a religious leader, a rabbi of rabbis, really, by the name of Nicodemus. And Nicodemus came at night to see Jesus because he didn't want to be seen during the day, I guess, to have a conversation with Jesus. And Nicodemus asked Jesus a bunch of questions, and Jesus told him in John 3:3, Jesus said to Nicodemus, you have to be born again to reach the kingdom of God. And two verses later in 3:5, Jesus said to Nicodemus, you have to be born of water and the Spirit to get into heaven, to reach the kingdom of God. And Nicodemus struggled with that, and so did I. I said, I've never heard this in the church I'm going to. Nobody's ever told me to be born again. What does that mean? So Larry Moody explained, obviously, that was the scripture, where John 3:3, John 3:5. And he explained what it means to be born again. And he said some like, you know, we're all born once in the flesh, all of us, and we're all going to die. That's one thing we all have in common. But you can be born again in the Spirit. And that is when you understand that there is a God who created you, that he had a problem with sin, and we are all sinners. I don't think any of you, if I ask each individually, have you ever sinned? I think you would all agree that you've sinned. Never met a person that said it never sinned. Because it could be a thought, it could be an action, it could be jealousy, it could be something you said or did, whatever. So Larry went on to explain that if you come to the conclusion, a realization that you believe God is who he claims to be, that he had a problem with humanity because we sinned, Adam and Eve sinned by eating the fruit from the forbidden tree, and we are all descendants from Adam and Eve. So we have sin nature in us, and so God has an issue with sin. Sin cannot be in heaven. Heaven is a perfect place. There's no room for sin. So God helped us with our dilemma by sending his son, Jesus Christ, to die on our behalf, to be the perfect sacrifice for our sins, for all our sins, past, present, and future. And if you believe that Jesus died for your sins and rose from the dead, then you're born again, if you say that in a prayer. And I think it's Romans 10:9 that says, if you believe it in your heart that Jesus is the Son of God and confess it with your mouth that he was raised from the dead, you will be saved. It doesn't say you could be, you might be, you have a good chance. It says you will be. Well, if you believe in God, God doesn't lie. God is love and true. Truth, he can't lie. So if he says you will be, it's a promise, like some other promises, which means we have a guarantee that we can be saved. There's also another verse in Romans, I believe it's 3:23 or 6:23, it says like, for the wages of sin is death, death meaning not the death we're all going to experience, but it's being taken away from the presence of God. It's spiritual death. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ. So it's a free gift that we can accept anytime, but we have to understand who God is and who we are. I had to understand that I can never be a good enough person to earn my way to heaven, no matter how good I am. I may be better than most of you, but I'm never going to reach the standard of God, perfection. So I'm never going to earn my way there. It's only through the free gift of God. There's also another Bible verse, I don't know where it is exactly, but it says something like, no one is righteous, not even one. That's talking to us, not one. So no matter how good you are, you're not going to get there by yourselves. But God has already provided a way for us. So when you think about that, you know, it's actually far more important, that decision, whether you make that decision to become a believer and have a personal relationship with God and have the Holy Spirit in you, than any other decision you ever make. It's far more important than life and death, because it determines where you're going to spend eternity. And eternity is a long time, as the word says, right? It's not just 70, 90 years we might live here. It's forever. It's a very long time. So I don't know where you are in your walk with Christ or in your belief, if you even believe in God, or, you know, I didn't for 28 years. He didn't for maybe 40 years, 45 years. I don't know. He was baptized in my pool, which was a great honor and a thrill for me. My goodness and him were baptized together in the pool where we live in Boca Raton. But, you know, I've been sharing a lot about my faith, and I want to take the opportunity, if there's anyone in the room that feels like I'm talking to you right now, if you don't know for certain that if you die tonight that you're not going to go to heaven, you ought to consider praying a prayer, that the prayer that I prayed 28 years ago when I accepted Christ. And I'm going to say that prayer in a few minutes. And it's not that you're joining a club, you're not joining a membership or a church, you're not even religious. No. It's far more. You're having a personal relationship with God and with Jesus Christ. And you're going to receive the Holy Spirit, which will give you wisdom and guidance how to live a life that is pleasing to Him. And out of thankfulness, you want to know more about Him. So if there's anyone in the room, I would like to, for all of us, to close our eyes. And I'm going to say a prayer. You can make this your prayer if you feel like it. Repeat the words that I'm saying. And if you make that decision, you are guaranteed to go to heaven, whether you die tonight or in 60 years from now. It doesn't matter. It's a guarantee. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we acknowledge that you are God and we're not. I acknowledge that I'm a sinner and that I need forgiveness of sin. I need help. Lord, I thank you that you will forgive my sins. I accept you as my Savior and my friend. Lord, I pray that you would come into my life now and change me from the inside out. And I thank you for forgiving my sins and for giving me a fresh start. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. The other good news is I'm going to give free golf lessons in heaven. I'm convinced of that. So if any of you need help, find me.
Not putting lessons, though.
No, putting lessons.
Let me just follow up on a quick thing, because often sure. I get people saying, so all you got to do is say this prayer and that's it, you're going to heaven. You have to believe it too. You have to have
believe it in your heart.
And once it is in your heart, then you'll keep looking for more answers and how to walk the proper path. And, you know, life changes for you. The wisdom might not come overnight, might not have just popped in your head now, but it'll get there.
It's the best decision I've ever made, and I made a lot of good ones in my life. I was very blessed, very fortunate, but by far the best decision. And I told you about the void I had. That void's been gone from the very moment when I said that prayer. I just prayed with you. Haven't felt that void in 28 years, and I'm convinced I never will. And it's helped me to live my life as a golfer, as a husband, as a father, as a friend. It just gives me security that I didn't have before. It gives me a love for other people. I didn't have before. And it makes me realize that I'm not in charge and not in control. God really is. And I'm blessed to have this personal relationship with him. That's why I'm here tonight, to share it with you. So thank you again.
We can wrap this up, or we can go through some questions. Hear some more from Bernhard about questions that you've given. I think I want to hear some questions. Some answers, too.
That's
and while we're getting the questions here, let me just put a little tag on the end of one of the stories. So
we may have had a couple of questions. I'll grab a few more if you've got them right now.
So Jack may have thought that that little German pro needed some extra work or whatever, but less than 15 years after they played that exhibition, right after Jack's greatest major championship victory in 1986, who put the green jacket on? That's the first question right there. Okay. Nice handwriting here on this one. How do you stay confident and believe in yourself when you're struggling on the course and others might not believe in you?
Yeah, that's a great question. It's such a hard game, golf. Let's face it, we all know it. And to have confidence is very difficult. But you know, one thing that's helped me, obviously, I practice very hard. I outwork other people. I know I'm not the greatest athlete. I'm not the tallest or strongest out there. But I figure if I outsmart them and outpractice them, I can be as good as anybody. But the question was, how do I struggle with my confidence, right? Or how do I cope with self-confidence issues? Well, I've obviously, my faith in God has helped me a great deal with that. Because I know ultimately he can help me at any time he wants to. And I can't help myself many of the times. I just, when I really, I'll give you a great example. I had a 6-foot putt in 1991 at Kiowa. And if I make that putt, Europe retains the Ryder Cup. If I miss it, the Americans get the Ryder Cup. As most of you know, I missed the 6-foot putt. And I had prayed a prayer before that putt. Before that putt, I prayed that, you know, not that I would make it, but I prayed God help me to have a quiet hand, to have good eyes to read the line, to be steady, to be confident, you know, to do the best I can. And I did the best I can, but the ball didn't go in. And so, you know, I could live with that because I knew it was just a game of golf. And I did the best I could, and I can look in the mirror anytime, any day, and I'm fine with that. While some others, you know, when they missed a putt like that, it ruined their career, or it took them down to a valley for a couple of years where it took them a long time to recover. So confidence is very important in the game of golf. I just try to go back to the basics. When I struggle, you know, I check my grip, my stance, my ball position, my weight distribution, my angles. If you go back to the basics, usually you can figure it out. Many of us get lost in so many things. What does my left finger do, or my right thumb, or my elbow, or, you know, all that. It's like looking at a tree. You got to work on the trunk, not on the branches and the leaves, because you can get lost real quick if you work on the leaves and the branches. So always work on the fundamentals.
Well, let me just add something, though, as well, as far as the putt there was concerned. He may have prayed for a steady hand. Those of us who read the putt like his caddy did would have prayed to tap down the spike mark on the putting line. He doesn't like to talk about it, but there was a spike mark. He had to either try and softly curl it around one side or ram it in the other. It was right dead on the line. And the pastor you mentioned, Larry Moody, obviously we all saw the putt missed. He worried about what it might mean to Bernhard. So it took him a while to get in touch with Bernhard, who was back in Germany. And he said, Bernhard, are you okay? Bernhard said, yeah, why, what are you worried about? He said, well, I mean, that putt, you missed that putt, it must be terrible. He said, well, it was just a putt. I mean, nobody's perfect. There was one perfect guy, they put him up on a cross. I just missed a putt. I'm going to be okay. He ended up winning in Germany. There, his home opened that week. So obviously, it was a very, had his priorities in order. Do we need to wrap, or you want one more?
I'm good.
Okay, so.
Everyone good?
Couple yeah. more maybe. Every
side, if you want.
Okay, every athlete has someone who has inspired them. Who was your inspiration when you were starting out as a kid? Because we all know your inspiration now is David Marr. I mean, maybe I added that last part. Just the last part. Just forget that and just go on. When you were a kid, who inspired you?
Well, there were two people. We had this caddy shack. I told you there were about 12 caddies. We had this little room, and somebody nailed on the wall a swing sequence of Jack Nicklaus. So that's all I looked at for, you know, 6 years while I was caddying. And we didn't have any golf magazines at the time. Golf wasn't even on television. You couldn't even see the Masters or the British Open at the time. It was just, nobody was interested, basically. But later, as I turned pro, Gary Player became my golfing idol for a number of reasons. First of all, he's about my size. He comes from South Africa, had a tough upbringing as well, and living through apartheid and all that kind of stuff. And he told me a bunch of stories where he played in this country and people threw things at him while he was making a swing and calling him names, and, you know, because of the apartheid issue. And we became very close friends. I was able to play a practice round with him. I was only 18 or 19 in the British Open, and he impressed me so much that he became my golfing idol. And he also believes in God. So he's a fitness fanatic, which I'm not quite a fanatic, but I like working out. He's won everything there's to win, and he's a great ambassador for the game of golf. So I try to emulate him for many years.
Let's talk about ambassadors. Where's table three? Where's George? All right, this is from George Simmons. Simon. In my opinion, you are the European ambassador who carries the torch for Europe. The Arnold Palmer of Europe. Who is the next Arnold Palmer of Europe when you retire?
Well, that's very kind of you. Thank you, George. But there's a lot of great people have gone before me, and there'll be a lot of great people after me, and I don't consider myself being the Arnold Palmer. There will never be an Arnold Palmer again. Doesn't matter where. We had Seve, we still have Faldo, we had Tony Jacklin, we had other guys that were really great players from Europe, and there'll be a lot more to come. I don't know who exactly that's going to be, but I'm convinced there'll be great champions who win majors and who, you know, represent the game of golf properly, and who are of good character and are great people and good role models.
Can I throw in one Arnold Palmer story? 1965, I told you my dad, his father, a PGA professional, died when he was 14 years old. 65, dad wins the PGA championship, the championship of his father's association. It was a huge moment for him, but what was even bigger is he got to play on the Ryder Cup team. Dad was from Texas, 65 Ryder Cup captain for US, was Byron Nelson, one of the all-time great people you're ever gonna get a chance to meet. And certainly any Texas golfer, he was a true hero and legend. Arnold Palmer's father, Deacon, was also a PGA professional. So when Dad came out on tour, Arnold put his arm around him, made sure he was in the right places and met the right people. It just really took care of him like Arnold did with so many golfers and other people, friends of the game, throughout his life. They go out and play alternate shot, Dad and Arnold together, in the first match. They were actually the second match out, but the first series of matches in the 65 Ryder Cup. Dad's all excited. He's representing his team, his family, his father, Byron Nelson, Arnold Palmer, it's his country. It was the biggest moment for him in the game. They lost 6-5 with Arnold Palmer as his partner. So at lunch, Dad was, crestfallen. He couldn't eat lunch. He couldn't stomach anything. He was sitting there, and Arnold's next to him. He's embarrassed. All he wanted to do was go home. He had let everything that was important to him, he had let everything down, including his dad's legacy. Up comes Byron Nelson. I mean, couldn't get any worse. Now his living hero walks up with his big brother right next to him. And Byron looks over at Arnold and he says, "Hey, Arnold, I wanted to talk to you about your partner this afternoon." And Arnold looked over at Dad and said, "I got my partner right here." Byron looked at Dad and Wing looked back at Arnold and said, "I was hoping you'd say so." They went out and won three of their next four matches. Dad won four of his next five matches, a couple of them being singles. And that was the way Arnold Palmer took care of those who were close to him. Those of us who watched him on TV, you know, you felt like he was giving you the thumbs up through the television set, or if you watched him in person, you thought he was pointing at you in the gallery. Well, he was. That's all I wanted to say about Arnold. Best ball striker you ever saw?
I would say at times it was Greg Norman. And there have been many others. So Lee Trevino comes to mind. Lee Trevino was maybe the straightest ball striker I've ever seen, most gifted, could curve that ball, could do everything. The only thing he couldn't do was hit the ball high. And that's probably why he never won Augusta. He just couldn't hit it high enough to stop it quick enough. But he was a magician.
Ken Schofield, who was the commissioner of the European Tour for a long, long time, stepped down 5-6 years ago, told me he was the best ball player Schofield had ever seen.
He hadn't seen many.
What do you do to improve the mental side of your game, which is such a strong part of your game, but those of us who end up having weaknesses, crises of confidence, what do you do to strengthen that mental side?
Well, I think I was born with a certain mental strength and a, you know, just a good outlook on life. But what gives me great strength now on a daily basis is reading the Bible. You know, I hear about sports psychologists, and actually a friend of mine is a sports psychologist, and we'll have some talks. And some of the stuff is pretty good. But as I listen to them and read stories and hear what they're doing, it's all in the Bible. It's unbelievable. It's in Proverbs, it's in Psalms, it's all throughout the Bible, you know. Forget the past, look forward to the future, to the present. Well, what do they say? Forget your double bogey and your bogey, you know, as quick as you can. The next shot is the most important. And it goes on and on like that. So I get a lot of strength from reading the Bible and from praying and trusting God. And obviously there's other things. You can breathe properly. My friend told me once, you know, sometimes you're too intense, which may have been. I sometimes wanted too much. And he says, you got to learn to flip the light switch on and flip the light switch off. And that picture helped me, because he said, the only time you need to focus is when you're over the ball or when you're close to the ball. You figure out your yardage, the wind, the lie, what club, then you make your swing. And then you flip the switch off again. You don't have to focus while you're walking from down the fairway and all that. And that helped, you know. So we relax. We talk about whatever we talk about with caddies, other players, or enjoy the scenery. But it would be very difficult to focus for 5 hours in a row. You know, 1 hour on the driving range and then 4 hours on the golf course. So I don't think anybody does. So it's a learning experience. But give you a quick story. I was playing the Irish Open. I was 19. First European event I ever led, and I had a two-shot lead with 9 holes to go, and I hit my tee shot on number 10, and as I pick up my tee, I'm thinking, so what are you going to say at prize giving? You know, what are you going to tell the media and the spectators, and what are you going to do with all the money you're going to be making, you know? And, yeah, right. So, you know, 2 holes later, my lead was gone, and I didn't win, obviously. So. It's the very thing you don't want to think about. You need to stay in the presence, you know, not get ahead of yourself.
You had mentioned caddies. You'd mentioned caddies. Your caddy is Terry Holt. And this is a legit question. How many shots does Terry Holt save you in a round? Terry, this has to be Terry.
No.
Okay. So there you go.
That's I can't answer that, because I wouldn't know if he, you know, if he wasn't there, would I take more shots or not? A caddy is very important, but at the same time, some players need more help than others. And I've won tournaments with my kids on the back who can't tell me what club to hit, and they can't read putting lines, and it wouldn't be fair, you know. I actually have a great record with my oldest son. He's made some good money caddying for me, and I won a tournament with my daughter a couple of years ago. And I've won with all sorts of caddies. So if it was just the caddy, you know, that makes a great player, I don't think so. I think the player is more important than the caddy. But it does help to have some good advice. You know, if you're in between clubs or touching the wind or anything, you know, any suggestion, any positive encouragement at the right time is much better. And my caddy, Terry Holt, is incredibly positive. Most caddies, you know, when you could just go bogey, bogey, par, bogey or something, they all say, oh, just, you know, another one of those. you know, I'm gonna not gonna make a big check. Let's just go home, forget this, you know.
Well, how many times.
That's how we think. That's how I think sometimes, and I'm sure the caddy thinks that way. But yeah, serious. But when he, you know, instead of saying that, he goes, "All right, you got 8 holes left. Let's see if we can go 3 under those next 8 holes," and that's the way to go. So, but I think are we doing okay on time?
Yeah, one more question.
They want to watch baseball. I know they do. Putting? I don't want to putt with a short putter.
We're gonna do that. Finally, have a chance to get him. Oh, and just in case you think Bernhard never makes a mistake, when his daughter caddied for him, they ended up winning the tournament, but they were in the second to last group. And so I noticed, because I was following the group doing on-course reporting, all of a sudden Christina's back out there, who is like literally the perfect daughter if you ever want to have a kid, taking the flag stick off and taking the flag off the stick, which is typically what happens when you win, the caddy or player gets to keep the flag. So Lanny Watkins starts saying, "Oh, she's taking the flag off the stick. She doesn't realize there's another group out there." And she came running off the green. And I said, "Chrissy, there's another group to play." And she turned around and ran back, all embarrassed, all our cameras are on her. And she comes running back because she and I are good pals. And she's like, "He told me to. He said I should get the."
Well, what happened is I got a tap in, 6-inch tap in to win the tournament because none of the guys behind me could catch me. And we're standing there watching the other two guys putt out. And she goes, "Dad, can I take the flag?" I said, "Sure, you can take the flag. Every caddy takes the flag." So she starts unrolling the top, pulls the flag out. We walk off, and there's 3 more players on the middle of the fairway. Where are we going? Where's the flag? You know.
Please don't tell Chrissy I told you that story. She hates that story. Last question, then we're going to draw 3 names and do the putt with the short putter. Maybe you can beat Bernhard. Do you shudder when you hear players take the Lord's name in vain when they hit a poor shot? And do you ever minister to them after the round?
I do shudder now, even though I did it myself for a number of years, I guess. But, you know, when I hear it, I feel saddened. And I first thing that comes to my mind is not Jesus' fault. It's not Jesus' fault that you just made a bad shot. And Larry Moody, this chaplain of ours, he told me this story. He's playing in Baltimore. He's a member there where he lives. And one day he goes out and he plays with this other member, and he's just, you know, chasey here and chasey there and F this way and chasey the next way. And so after about 8 holes, he's had enough. And so Larry hits a bad tee shot and goes, "Buddha, Buddha." And the guy looks at him and says, "What's that, Buddha, Buddha? What are you talking about?" "Well, you're Jesus Christ, everything here, and Jesus Christ left and right, so I'm calling Buddha, you know?" And made him aware of what he's doing, you know? Well, why are you using the only holy name in the world to swear when you hit a bad shot? So,
before we get to the putting, one quick question, sort of the opposite side of that. The thing that kind of irritated me when I would hear you guys giving praise at the end of a tournament was that it seemed to me like you were saying, "God likes you more than the guy who's a runner-up." Is that what you were saying?
No, that's not what I was saying, but it probably comes over that way to some people who don't believe in God. And when I win, I'd like to give honor and glory to God because I feel, he's blessed me with a gift and talents to play this game, with a body that still functions, with a mind that functions. And yes, I have to put some work behind it and practice and do all that kind of stuff, but he deserves the glory, not me, and the honor. And so I just want to make people aware of that, you know, and give him the glory. And that doesn't mean that I don't put my effort into it and all that, but I can see where, you know, it could come over strange to the people who don't believe in God, but I still think it's the right thing to do. I'm not ashamed to let people know what my faith is. I'm not going to go around and bang my Bible on their heads, but I'm also not going to be scared to tell the truth. And I believe that's the truth, and I'm very happy to share it with whoever wants to listen.
Also fallen short, but was given the opportunity to at least be there and compete. So now we get a chance to see who's going to be able to get him to give praise when they beat him in a putting contest. So, 3 names. This is going to be great. That's it. It's the putter, obviously.
Take a deep breath. And he draws it back and follows through on line.
Oh, did he give it enough?
He took a horrible bounce, but he made it! Don't leave me hanging. Great putt. All right. Oh, this is the very modern.
How far do you want to get? You said it. So it's your game. You said it.
Is this? I mean, I know I'm old, but is this fair that I have to use this thing? All right. Wow. What are we doing? Michael, what are we doing? Where is he? I set the rules. Let's go all the way back here. I need some chance. Right here. How's that?
We can go to the next room.
I might hurt somebody on my follow through. All right. I'll go first. I give you a read. How's that?
Okay. So it's how many putts per? Two putts per player.
What is it? Closest to the hole, or do we?
Closest to the hole.
All right. Ooh, way too hard. Go in. Oh! It's all yours. Go left. Oh!
His 102nd victory worldwide, Bernhard Langer.
Thank you. Thanks for being a good sport. Appreciate it. Want to take that? Yeah, I got the better putter.
Bruce, what are you doing? Well done.
Sorry. That's pure luck.
Oh.
You know that. Thank you.